It is time for Q&A.
For the clarification, so for our protocol, we use mostly, well, we try to do the load balancing based on the size of the transactions or the cost of processing the transactions. And it was suggested by Address to extend it also to have a look at the state size to make sure that in every single shard, we have also the similar size. We initially didn't think about it because the storage doesn't seem to be a bottleneck. On the other hand, in the long run, it might be, because if you say that you will store something in the blockchain, well, you have to store it for, well, potentially forever, which is complicated. So we are currently also looking onto that. Although it is not clear whether you want to calculate the storage as a, for instance, for smart contracts, as the size of the state of the smart contracts or the amount of the modification of the smart contract. Probably both. That's the question and an answer.
I just wanted to take a note on the implementation of our protocol RingBFD, which is inside the ResilientDB. I really suggest everyone to take a look at our ResilientDB platform and take a look and to see how we can implement actually permission blockchain system or BFT consensus sharding protocols and other.
I want to ask a question about RingBFD. So basically, the theoretical advantage of linear communication among shards is kind of clear, but is there a practical advantage? And like, did you quantify this? Can you detail this a bit?
When it comes to the consensus in multi-shard transaction, when you scale up to 15 regions, the previous fork usually have all-to-all communication. And in the practical system, when you scale up to hundreds of nodes, the communication would always be a bottleneck. For example, in previous work, like AHL reference committee would be the bottleneck. And the other works, this pattern of all-to-all communication would make the performance of the system to throughput the latency a little bit even worse. And usually when people talk about the communication and the latency, it's all about round trip time. But when it comes to the actual protocol, when it comes to the practical system working, the RTT or the round trip time is not the only barrier for the latency and the performance of the system. The pattern of communication, the amount of messages that are being processed for one instance of cross-shard consensus to happen is one of the main and most important overlooked things that are missing in the previous work that we take a look into. And this whole ring architecture that we go over the ring with the linear amount of communication, which makes performance increasing and scaling the performance by increasing the number of shards completely linear. So scaling up to more shards would be linear, but in the previous work, since there's an all-to-all communication, scaling would not be linear. So RingBFD scales much, much better than our other previous sharding consensus protocols.
And if I can add to that, of course, we have here two linear terms. We have the linear term due to the cluster sending, but that's the small thing, because if your shards are not going to be too big, that is an optimization. But we're really talking about communication between shard and shard. So one shard talks to one other shard, whereas indeed, like Sajjad explained, a lot of protocols that really try to do it as fast as possible. If you have five shards in your transactions, you're going to have five shards talking to all five other shards. And that will blow up if your transactions become anything more than just move something from one shard to another.
So I understand the argument, but you had experiments which would actually be apples to apples, meaning like you would use cluster sending, so both for previous work and for your work, just to make sure that for cluster sending there is no difference. But so I would just like to understand, how did you measure this?
So your question is that if the cluster sending the cluster sending solution applies to the other protocols,
yes, then if you would do that, what would be the difference? Yes.
So actually, this part is not trivial. As you are saying, you can apply the cluster sending solution to all those protocols, because the proof of safety and liveness of these protocol are based on the pattern of communication that the whole recovery process of RingBFD and other protocol relies on the pattern of communication. The faulty node how would be the novelty here, the subtle point here is that when there is a faulty node in different two clusters and the cluster cluster sending protocol is not behaving as expected, what would be the recovery process? How we can fastly recover from this process and do your cross-shard transaction in that order of thing. Our recovery solutions that are explained in the paper deep and completely in detail will also explain how we are handled those scenarios and situations.
Let me add something here. So cluster sending solution can be added to any paper, but the design of the protocol itself will not change, right? And for example, AHL itself is having a reference committee, which is basically talking to all other committees or all other shards. And that itself, even if you have a linear communication, that does not mean AHL will stop talking to all of the shards or SHAPA will stop talking to all of the shards. That itself means there's a huge amount of communication which is bound to happen. In Ring BFT, we're just ensuring that one shard talks to another shard in a ring pattern. So, I mean, the combination all. So this, as Yella said, there are like two levels of linear combination happening. One is cluster sending, other is the protocol itself. The protocol is basically asking things to go in the ring flow. So even if you remove one combination, the other will still remain. There's a bottleneck. There was a bottleneck reference committee. In other protocol, there's one sending to everyone. So the bottleneck still exists. So that's half of the solution.
And from my experience, I looked at actually similar things in another project, but in that project, what you did see, if you have a multi-sharding protocol that works just like in two or three phase with just massive amounts of cross-shard communication, that works fine as long as you have the resources for that. Then it's gonna have very good latency, very good performance, of course. But it also will cause issues if you want to do locking, to do like transaction management. It will cause a lot of performance issues if you're really trying to max out throughput on all shards. And it's actually really much more optimized for single shard transactions than multi-shard. If you want to reliably support multi-shard transactions with some sort of locking to do concurrency control, then doing it in the Ring BFT way is basically the only thing that can give you not too much issues from what I've seen in some trials and other projects.
So for the first talk, mitosis, given that you guys are from LEC, what's the status of the code?
So we implemented, we have a very, I mean, very basic proof of concept implementation in Fabric where we, honestly, I was not taking care of the implementation, but I try to answer as I can, and maybe my colleague can take over and answer in the chat. So I believe we implemented the crash fault tolerance protocol where we created chains with 10 to 20 nodes, 40 nodes, I think up to 50 nodes. And we split that and we measure how long it takes to effectively to boost new tile chains from that. Then we have cross-chain protocols for asset transfer and for knowledge transfer that allows proving either statement about a blockchain to another so that clients can communicate with each other even if they attach to different chains, and also can send transactions from one another. I would have to look at this exact numbers, but for our implementation, we for splitting, if I recall, to split a shard with 20 nodes, we need like 35 seconds or so, and the time to split a bigger chain grows linearly with the number of nodes, but this could be optimized, just that we didn't do that in our code. Yeah, it was like below 5 minutes for splitting.
Thank you, Georgia. I have no more questions.
Yeah, I have a quick question. Will this affect miners in any way? Or should I say storage providers?
You're specifically referring to Filecoin.
Correct.
So, of course, this is independent work that we invited because it's interesting. I mean, if authors of the papers already thought about this, I'm inviting them to answer the question, yes.
Okay, thank you.